Christmas card in an old dusty trunk, and it brings back sweet memories.
Good morning. We're here. We're together. It's a bright and interestingly warm day for this time of year. My name is Grant Dawson. We have Andrew Nicholson over there. We have Martin and Kessa at the back. And we are with, who else? Well, Shelby is involved in this. Al Pollock's going to read the scripture reading, and we even have a surprise guest during the announcements today, whom I think you will know. So don't get too excited about that. Merry beginning of the Christmas season. As I said last week, this is actually the beginning of the church year. We start the story of Jesus at Christmas, and this is leading up to it. So this is our New Year celebration for the church, and we're going to begin by reading some of a traditional passage, which is read at this time of year. We're going to begin today with just a hint of Christmas music, and then we're going to burgeon out in the next couple of weeks to full Christmas music and all our other Christmas activities, which you'll be getting in the newsletter, and we'll talk more about some of them at the end of the service. Our theme today is hope, the first Advent candle, the first theme we come to. And with that in mind, let's begin with this. We believe in a God of extravagant and indiscriminate love. That's the basis. That's why we're here. That's what calls us together here. And we act out that belief, because belief is not just something in the head. We act it out with our basic guiding values, spirituality, that we're always connected with something bigger, justice. Because of that, we're interested in the broader community and not just about ourselves, and community. Especially remembering, as we do each week, that we are on native land here, the land of the people who have been here for millennia and who have guarded and loved this land, and we share that with them and hope that we can work together always to make this a better land and a richer land and a land filled with love and community. Compassion, it's what we show to one another. Hospitality. Some of you have your coffee, and you can have more after, and just the shaking of hands, the singing together, the praying together, being together. That's hospitality. Passing the peace. Now, normally we say, peace be with you, or something like that. I came up with advantageous Advent. Yeah, not good. If you want an alternative, the best I could come up with, and the wordsmiths in the congregation can spend the entire week thinking about this. Fran, sit down, because you're one of them. Hopeful Advent is what, if you want to give another blessing rather than just Christ's peace, maybe hopeful Advent would be appropriate for this day. But we share with one another. By the way, if you just want to sit and be quiet at this point in the service, that's wonderful. And if you wish just to sit because you don't want to wander around or you can't, that's good too. We'll come over and shake your hand and say, hopeful Advent. Hopeful Advent. Could we have our Advent candle lighter up here, please? Soon. Where is our Advent candle lighter?
He's coming.
Oh, there he is. Hello. How are you? Oh, you've got your own lighter. That's wonderful. Now, we're picking a candle that looks like it's a candle for hope. Which one will be one of these three? Which one do you want to light? No, that one's off to, that one's for joy. No, we don't light the Christ candle yet. So one of these. Let's light this one. There we go. Oh, sometimes you have to give it a couple of tries. Okay, let's take it away now. There we go. Thank you very much. Thank you for doing that. Okay. Why don't you stand here? We're going to say the words that will appear on the screen now about lighting the candle. We light a candle of hope in a world where people are not always hopeful. We light a candle of hope, though some may have night no either way. We light a candle of hope, so some may have warmth to give them strength. We light a candle of hope, knowing hope has power. We light a candle of hope. Thank you. Now let's sing a song about hope. Then you can go, all right, yeah, you can go back. There you go. And the kids can go out at this point, so.
All right, sing with me. I think we're just singing the first verse, but let's give it some gusto. A candle is burning, a flame warm and bright. A candle of hope in December's dark night. While angels sing blessings from heaven's starry sky, our hearts we prepare now, for Jesus is nigh.
It's him. Now, I know that's going to give him, from some of you, 5 extra points. But if you really like it, I picked it. Anyway, there you go.
Give me some credit here. The darkness hide thee. Though the eye made blind by sin, thy glory may not see.
Pray. Spirit always alive in our world. Sadly, sometimes we forget that presence. We become caught up in the things that block our path, events that annoy us, people with whom we disagree, situations that fill us with fear, our own sense of failure. At those times when we have not lived up to being who we know we should be. Let us now then open our hearts to you. And in knowing that you are love, let us find a deep sense of healing and renewal within ourselves. Knowing that you are forgiving, allow us to forgive ourselves and to forgive others who have hurt us. Knowing that you are love, help us ourselves to become an embodiment of that love in our daily acts. Not caught up always with how well things are done or how much we have done or how much we have accomplished, but rather concentrating our hearts and our minds on how much we have loved. How much we have been able to share, how many hurts we have identified around us and have reached out to bring healing, how many problems we have seen and not looked upon them as insurmountable blocks to our path, but rather as steps where we may learn to do things better with courage and in hope. Living Spirit, be with us here, and may we carry that presence with us from this place into a world where the message of hope is sadly needed. Amen. Grace and renewal. I think we've done something like this before, but it's worth repeating because I think that what we're about to do is important, and it's something we don't often do. I'm going to ask you just to sit and reflect on places in your life which give you comfort. Our theme for today is not only hope, but a big comfy chair. Isn't that nice? A place you can sit and just feel at peace. Or it may not be a place. It may be a person, someone you know. You visit them, and you just feel better. You've had a terrible day. They come over for tea in the afternoon, and suddenly all that burden has been lifted. Or it can be an activity, something you really enjoy doing. And when you feel almost too tired to do anything else, somehow there's an energy to go in and play with your coin collection or read a book or whatever it is that brings you comfort. So think of things, people, places in life that give you that sense of just being comfortable. And then go on from that to say, what is it about it? I mean, we have in our family room six places to sit. They're all comfortable. They're all good chairs. There's not one that's much better than the other. And yet I have, as probably you do in your house, my chair. All right. If you come and in your company, you could sit in it. But it draws me. You know, I have six chairs here. I'll sit in this one because that's my chair. What is it that draws you to those places of comfort? What makes them comfortable? I guess this is another way of saying that. So take about 30 seconds to think about that, you know, places that bring you comfort, and then turn to those around you, and if they seem to want to chat, talk about that. You know, here's where I like to go. What brings you comfort? What gives you a sense of being at peace? Let's do that now. Thank you for that. I hope you felt something in that, maybe a sense of comfort. And also, I would like to say thank you for your united churchness about that. We are an inclusive community, and people approach activities like that in many different ways. If my son was here and we said we're going to do that in church, he would probably throw himself on the ground and cry because he's introverted. I didn't come here to talk to people, and some of you just sat quietly, and that's okay. That's part of it too. You don't need to always do what everybody else is doing. You need to do what this place calls you to do, which is to be comfortable and to find peace. Some music from Andrew, which he also chose. There we go.
This is a song by a musician named Frank Turner, and it came into my mind because when I think of hope or comfort, one of the things that I think brings the most hope for me is just the simple act of kindness. History's been leaning on me lately. I can feel the future breathing down my neck. And all the things I thought were true when I was young and you were too turned out to be broken. And I don't know what comes next. In a world that has decided that it's going to lose its mind, be more kind, my friends. Try to be more kind. Mm-hmm. started raising walls around the world now, like cackles raised upon a cornered cat. On the borders in our heads, between the things that can and can't be said, we stop talking to each other, and there's something wrong with that. So before you go out searching, don't decide what you will find. Be more kind, my friends. Try to be more kind. You should know. You're not alone. Double comes and trouble goes. How this ends, no one knows. So hold on tight when the wind blows. The wind blew both of us to sand and sea, where the dry land stand is hard to say. As the current drags us by the shore, we can no longer say for sure who's drowning or if they can be saved. But when you're out there floundering like a lighthouse, I will shine. Be more kind, my friends. Try to be more kind. Like a beacon reaching out to you and yours, for me and mine. Be more kind, my friends. Try to be more kind. In a world that has decided that it's going to lose its mind, be more kind, my friends. Try to be more kind.
It's nice when you have a music reader who shares your likes in music, or at least some of them. I've actually heard Frank Turner twice in concert here. He was introduced to me by my son who lives in England, which is where he's from. So thanks for that, Andrew. Al, could you give us our reading for this morning? First reading of Advent.
Good morning, folks. Since we seem to be into bragging rights this morning, I'd like to take credit, or try to, for that mountain view that greeted you this morning. Scripture reading this morning is a very short one.
He turned himself off after a lot of time, so we just reset. There we go. Well done.
No? Okay. Y'all know?
You enjoy this job.
Test. There we are. Okay, I'll start again. Since people are trying to take bragging rights for the music this morning, I thought I'd start off by attempting bragging rights for the mountain view that greeted you this morning. Attempt. So folks, our scripture reading this morning is from Isaiah, and it's verses 1 and 2. So I'm going to encourage you to listen very, very carefully right from the start, because the scripture lesson is so short If you drop off for just a second, you'll miss most of it. Comfort, comfort, my people, says your God. Speak compassionately to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her compulsory service has ended, that her penalty has been paid, that she has received from the God's hand double for all her sins. Thanks for the word from God, for the people of God. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Al. Actually, it was so short that Al wrote back to me and said, is this it? I think he thought I'd forgotten the rest, which we usually read. But that's all you're going to hear more in the coming weeks. We're adding a section on each week in Advantageous Advent. Now, that is a passage that we usually read in one form or another at this time of year. It's part of the pre-Christmas reading list, and it's a very powerful one. I mean, you can see why, because when you read it, it elicits thoughts about Jesus, whose whole ministry seemed to be about comforting people who were sick, comforting people who had gone through loss, comforting people who felt broken in the world or who couldn't understand the world around them. He spoke to them, he healed them, he touched them, he called them into community. And that's very true. But you've also got to remember that when this was originally written by Isaiah, or whatever the name of the person was who wrote the end of the book, we think it's different from the beginning because of the timeline, but whoever the author was thinking, it was not about Jesus in particular, it was about God's vision for the world and what God says to us always. And it was very appropriate for his time as well. The Jewish people were now in primarily two places. In Jerusalem, where they lived in poverty among the ruins of the city, as the Babylonians had blown it down, basically. And the leadership of the Jews, who now lived in Babylon and had lived there for 59 years. They had been taken captive, moved away. Babylonians quite smartly had seen, if you take away the doers and the shakers, the people that are left will not do much, and they hadn't. The prophet is saying to both of them, you're frustrated. You feel alone, you feel lost. What's the use of doing this? God's forgotten us. We're being paid back for something bad, and we don't know what it is, and we're just here, and we're alone. I speak you words of comfort. And they were beginning to hear news, because they didn't have the internet and television, but that from the north, the Persians were sweeping down on Babylon. Probably by the time this was written, one of the major battles had already taken place. The Babylonian army had actually been defeated. And everyone was holding their breath. What's going to happen now? What's going to occur now? What's the next event that's going to shake us? And he was just saying, comfort. Things are changing. You're absolutely true in your thinking. Things are changing. Whether you're in Jerusalem feeling leaderless and lost, or in Jerusalem feeling that your lives have been thrown away and that there's really nothing important left to do, whoever you are, comfort. God is active in the world. God is there. God is going to do something. Get comfortable and wait and see. And for us today, that message of hope is still there, isn't it? It's still there. Excuse me, I'm going to stop at this point because my iPhone has begun to talk to me. I don't know what it is saying or why it is saying it or what it is playing.
Responsibility and a strategic imperative.
This is amazing. It's gone to a news story about modern day Israel. I don't know why where it picked that up from, or why it will not be quiet, and I don't even know where it's coming from. Well, it obviously was. It picked up something I said. Something sounded like H or Hey, S-I-R-I, and then it looked up an article on the problems in Israel. And now if I could figure out how to turn this off, because I don't know where this is coming from. It's coming from somewhere. It's on. Hey, Siri, be quiet. Hey, Siri, turn off sound. It's a podcast. I don't want it. Go away. It's there. All right. And fascinating. And you may not have heard it, but it was just loud enough. Then I thought it was just answering some stupid question, but it kept going on. And we may have just listened to that article for the rest of the service. It may have been quite smart. But for us, the message that was told back then, we still need the comfort. We live in a world which is broken, a world which there are many hurts that need to be healed, a world with wars, a world with separation, a world with climate change that we don't seem to know how to control or what to do with. So we too need to hear these words first and above all, comfort. I'm bringing you good news. I'm bringing you hope. Now often when we talk about hope, of course, we really confuse it because we have many uses for that word, and the use we are most used to saying is simply thoughts that are nice. You know, that's what hope is. Hope is nice thoughts. I hope we have ice cream tonight for supper. I hope our neighbor comes over and brings back my shovel. Or, you know, on a bigger scale, we hope there is peace between Israel and the Palestinians eventually. We hope that we can control climate change. And all of these are good things. I'm not putting these hopes down, but that's what they are. They're simply things that we've brought to mind, and they seem pleasant and comfortable, and we'd like to see them happen, and we say, that's what I hope. That's what hope is. The trouble with it, that there's no substantiation. You know, I don't know if we have ice cream at home. I mean, it's just a dream that I have in my head. I don't know right now how Israel and the Palestinians are going to get over their 2,500-year-old battle, but, you know, it would be nice. Hope in the biblical sense, hope in the sense that we're talking about it today, hope in the sense that Isaiah, the writer of 3rd Isaiah, was trying to do, is something far deeper, something far more fundamental to who we are and how we think, and to our faith in general. It wasn't about fantasies. It was about saying, look it, I know where you are in the world. I know what your problems are. I know what the things you want are, the hopes you have in that sense. I know all this. What you got to do first is find comfort. Get away, get into a place where you can sit down and hear my message and allow your mind to focus on the fact that God is with you. Love embraces you. Love surrounds you. Love guides you. And you see, in a very real sense, this idea of comfort leads to that deeper sense of hope. Because when you're comfortable, when you're sitting pleasantly and feel your body is at rest and you're safe and you're secure, it's then that you can look out into the world and begin to see visions, not just of dreams, fantasies, but of things you can do in a concrete, active, sustainable way that will bring about change. Right here today. And that's the center of what our faith is about. And we need to have those moments of comfort in your chair, with your neighbor, in that wonderful, quiet place that you go to in the mountains, wherever that is. We need to make that a part of our lives. Because it's only when we have that comfort as a fundamental that we can really be hopeful people who can say, yes, I'm being embraced. I'm not caught up in the past. thinking about things I've done wrong. Oh, I've done that wrong. Oh, I've done that wrong. Yeah, that's true. You have. That's not what we're talking about. We're not caught in some fantasy future. Well, maybe someday this will happen. Maybe someday that happens. Someday I'll go to the moon. You know, read a cartoon the other day where someone said, I want to be like my father. He always dreamed about being a millionaire. And they said, is your father a millionaire? No, but he dreamed about it too. You see, that's not the sort of thing we're talking about. We're talking about a hope which we can see is part of what we can do in the world to bring about peace, to bring about healing, to bring about renewal. So we've got to make those places, those comfortable places, because we're so often, when we allow our minds to wander, they don't go there. I mean, it seems odd. You know, why would you go someplace hard and difficult and annoying when you can go to some place of comfort and peace? Well, because that's the way our minds work. I mean, very seldom have you been wakened up in the middle of the night at 3 o'clock to think about bunnies on the front lawn. No, you think, oh, I've got that meeting next Tuesday. What am I going to do? No. Take time. It can just be a few minutes. I love doing it when I'm walking, not when I'm driving, but at stoplights. You know, I've now got 60 seconds just to stand here and actually look around at the world. I've never noticed that building before. That's different. Look at those people over there. I wonder what they're doing. Just allow the mind to relax and absorb the world. At the University of California in San Francisco, scientists have found that when rats have a new experience, like exploring an unfamiliar area, their brains show a certain pattern of activity. They're learning the maze, and you can see the brain lighting up as they go through this maze and figuring out how it goes and how you can go this way and how you can go that. But only when the rats take a break from their exploration do they process those patterns in a way that seems to create a persistent memory of experience. Lauren Frank, who headed up the study, says, almost certainly, downtime lets the brain go over experiences it had, solidifying them and turning them into permanent long-term memories. And when the brain is constantly stimulated, you prevent this learning process. Think about that the next time you're trying to learn something. Maybe you've decided you're going to learn French this year and you've just gone over the vocabulary list and over them and over them again and over them again. No. Go over them a little bit and then do something and let the brain organize things. It's like you're sending to-do lists into an office and you just keep sending them in, and the office has no way of handling all these to-do lists. No, here's a to-do list. Learn these 15 words. Okay, give me time to learn the 15 words before you dump the next 15 on me. At the University of Michigan, there was a similar study that found that people learn significantly better after a walk in nature. Aren't we in a wonderful church here? You can walk out the door any day. Walk in nature. And that's better than a walk in an urban environment, suggesting that processing a barrage of information leaves people fatigued. When you're relaxed, when you're sitting in your comfy chair, when you've taken a break, had a coffee, wandered out in the field. By the way, Angie says, watch for the hawks out there, they'll dive on you. But it's then that your mind is open to thinking new thoughts. You're not just going over things again and again and trying to get there. The moment we allow ourselves to be embraced by the world, we then are able to look at the world in a new way. We can see the pattern, see the bigger picture, which we usually forget when we're concentrating on one particular evil or one particular problem or one particular situation. Just sit back to look at everything and see things you've never noticed before. Now, I know one person can put up their hands to this. There might be others. Were any of you at the Knox Carol Festival last night? Yeah, one person. Oh, well, I was emceeing it, so I'm glad somebody was there. But Knox has a secret. I'm going to tell you it now, and you won't tell any of your friends, because we don't want this out there in the world. They have a magic place, and it's called the Pit. Yeah. Under the new section of Knox, which is an ironic name, it was built in 1960, but we still call it the new section there. Under that, there is no development. There's a huge basement space, probably as large as, if not larger than this. Windows are all around the top, the basement windows. Gravel floor, there's light, there's water, there's heat, but nothing has ever been developed down there. But that's where the magic takes place. You go in there and it's empty. Strangely, weirdly, mysteriously empty. And then you leave for 6 months. And you go back in there again. And it's filled with junk. It's just grown. I mean, it springs up from the earth. And it's frustrating. Now, of course, what really happens, and I realize this, is people at Christmas say, what can we do with all the extra Christmas decorations? Put them in the pit. No one will ever notice. We've changed hymn books. What do we do with the 5,000 old hymn books we have? Let's put them in the pits. We've taken pews out of the church. What do we? Where do we put them? In the pits. Here's pictures that Joanna gave us for the church to hang on a wall. They're ugly. Put them in the pit. The worst for Knox was we used to do musicals, and you had these huge stage pieces that people had worked on. We had the mountain from Brigadoon. We had the village from Little Abner. Well, you don't want to throw them out. We may want them again. I mean, who knows when someone's going to come and say, do you have a mountain? Well, we do. And you know where it is? It's in the pit. So about once every 10 years, the board gets frustrated and says, we have to clean out the pit. And you have a work day. And what we have had, it doesn't always happen, but there has been a time when you get 20 people show up to clean out the pit, and there's no plan. Uh-huh. Yeah, well, I think we should move these over there and those over there. No, I think we should clean everything first, because if it's dirty, there's no use having it. Well, we should maybe separate it into what we're going to send here and what we're going to send there and what we're going to keep. Well, I could take some of this. Well, we should have a sale, so we should put... And you spend half the time debating what you're going to be doing, because nobody has that overall vision. No one has sat on their comfy chair and said, okay, what's the best way to empty a pit short of a flamethrower? Which might not be that safe either, but you know, and has a plan. And that's what we need in life. We have far too many people running around with the cause of the day. This needs to be handled. Absolutely, no problem. Yeah, we know what needs to be. But this is more important. Well, my concern is about this. And we don't do anything because everyone's running around looking excited about something. We need to all sit down in our comfy chairs, say, okay, this is the new beginning. This is our Advent. This is when we see what the world needs. Analyze what we have to give, what we can find as a resource, and we make our plans. That, by the way, is why we pray at the beginning of church meetings. It isn't just a prayer that the meeting be short. It's a prayer far more fundamentally to separate us from the rest of the world and all the concerns of the past and the future and say, we're here to do this. Let's begin with that comfort. Begin with the hope that we have the resources. We know that God is with us. We have a vision. It may not be the perfect vision, but it's there. And in that spirit, we can act. We can do things. The same thing, of course, is necessary in our own lives about ourselves. We need to take those times when we stop and we say, who am I really? I've got caught up being a caretaker. I've got caught up being a caregiver. I've got caught up being the accountant. I've got caught up being this, and I've got caught up in these things, and I've missed some of the things that I really wanted to do. There's nothing sadder than that, I think, in life, to hear people who get older, and some of you here are getting older, who say, you know, I always wanted, and I never did. Why? I never sat down and put that into my thinking. Here's another thing I could do. I really like that. How do I do it? This time of year, we tell old stories. You've heard Isaiah before. We're going to read some passages later from Luke and from Matthew that you've probably heard before as well. You know them. Some of you can say some of them off by heart. But we tell the old stories because the meaning remains. They call us to a place of comfort where God is with us. And in that place, we get to see the world with new eyes, see ourselves with new eyes, and see our action in a much broader and healthier way. So for the comfort that God gives us, simply by being with us, thanks be to God. We move now to the table of Christ. This is one of those places, I hope, of comfort. One of those places we come and we just accept what is given to us. And many of us find it hard to accept things like help or advice or anything else. We accept them, we partake of them, and we become community sharing together. We gather here at a simple table, probably one of the most basic images we have in our mind, and certainly one of the most basic religious symbols in the world, just a table, a dining room table. You think about it, dining room kitchen tables, they're a very central part of all of our lives normally. We gather here because even if we are walking through the valley of deep darkness, we fear no evil. God is with us. God prepares a table before us. The oil of gladness is poured out. The bread of goodness and mercy is shared. Our cups overflow. We are comfortable because of that presence. This is not our table. Our table as Red Deer Lake United Church, our table as the United Church of Canada, it is Christ's table. It is the table of Jesus open to all. Here we gather to acknowledge something, a presence greater than ourselves that calls us here and prepares this meal, something to be sought after, something to be explored fully, not just once, but throughout our lives. And everyone present at the service, no matter who you are, no matter what your background, even no matter what your theological understanding, but if you're doing that exploring, if you're doing that seeking, if you're looking for that comfort, this is your table as well. This is not about our worth as individuals or our position or our degrees or our titles. This is about being people together, sharing the gift that is given. And that's how we always begin at the table, by stressing that this is a sharing. In the early church, it was a potluck meal. Everybody met and brought something. They put it down. Miraculously, it was the meal of Christ. So we talk about sharing in the church, how we support people, how we support one another, how we support the ongoing work of this church. Food pantries, speaking of meal, central to the church. Last night, the Carol Festival is always for the food bank. We have our food bank, local food bank. We share that way. We share the work by donating online. You can donate if you wish out at the hub after the service, or you can donate by mail. This money goes to support us and to support the work, the works that we do. There are many other ways, of course. Showing up. There is no meal if there are no people to enjoy it. Bringing your friends. Are they looking for something too? Do they want a comfortable place that perhaps we could provide? And of course, for volunteering, for helping to make all this happen. And we certainly are much more aware of this at the Christmas season, when people are busy doing one thing and another to make Christmas that special time of the year. These are our ways of giving. And today we symbolize this by the giving of bringing up the meal that we will share together. we gather, we get to know one another as we open ourselves to the eating of Christ's banquet. And to that end, I would ask, do we have any prayers this week? Prayers of thanksgiving, prayers of joy, prayers of concern, things we would like to bring up to the community that need to be held in our minds and our hearts. You're going to have to be extra loud today because I'm staying up here. But anything anybody has? Yes. Good. A family prayer for grandparents. That is the heart of who we are. Fran. Okay, so Ralph and Irene, baby Emma, ongoing prayers, the first part, and I'm sorry to hear about Ralph and Irene. We tend to forget about COVID right now, and last week I've been reminded several times that it's still with us. Anything else out there? Celebration or? All right, let us pray. Spirit of Christ, we gather here at the table you have given us. We sometimes feel inadequate. Help us to know that the bread you provide will give us the strength that we need, the endurance. The cup you give will fill us with a spirit of vitality and search and action. Loving God, be with us here. It's the Spirit of Christ living in this place, in our hearts, in our minds, in our acts each day. And help us as we watch one another come to the front and take the elements to sense that we are a part of something living and vital that has tenacity and strength. Our theology is not simply points of belief that can be debated. It is a lifestyle that calls us to be with Christ in all we do. When we hear and see the world of the news around, the news of the world around us, may we realize that in our actions each day, in small ways, we change that world. As we hear of the concerns and pains, the illnesses and the celebrations and the joys around us, help us to be a part of them with our support and our care and our laughter and our joy. Here we are transformed by what we eat into who we can be as the people of Christ. And for this we give thanks and say together, Jesus' prayer. Eternal Spirit, earth maker, pain bearer, life giver, source of all that is and that shall be, Father and Mother of us all, loving God in whom is heaven, the hallowing of your name echo through the universe. The way of your justice be followed by peoples of the world. Your heavenly will be done by all created beings. Your commonwealth of peace and freedom sustain our hope and come on earth. With the bread we need for today, feed us. In the hurts we absorb from one another, forgive us. In times of temptation and test, strengthen us. From trials too great to endure, spare us. From the grip of all that is evil, free us. For you reign in the glory and the power that is love, now and forever. Amen. On the night when he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, the simplest of elements for a meal. And he broke it, and shared it with his friends. And as he did, he said this, to their surprise, I'm sure, each time you eat the bread, each time you remember has been broken, remember me, remember my brokenness. And remember, too, that in the midst of brokenness, there is healing and comfort and hope. Then he took the cup at the end of the meal and again said, in a very non-traditional way, this cup will remind you of my blood shed for you. Remind you of a covenant that has been made between you and me, that I will be with you always. My life, which is what blood symbolized to the Hebrew people, my life will be in your life. You'll find what you need in comfort, giving hope. Today, I would call you forward in a minute to share these elements. We have two serving stations, three serving stations, two. How many do we have, Kim? Just two. I guess there are rows. So I would ask you to come forward. There is gluten-free bread for those of you who wish to have gluten-free bread. And if you come up the center aisles and go back on the outside. I'd ask the servers, the people who will be at the front, to please come forward. And let us together share a meal, comforting meal, a meal of hope. I don't know, I'll do the wine, so I'll stand over here maybe. Okay. Please come. Thank you. We pray after communion. Let us pray together. We give thanks that bread broken brings wholeness, and that our lives and our community are healed in love. We give thanks that wine poured out replenishes, and that in our gathering experience there is always renewal and hope. We give thanks that time spent reflecting on the action of Jesus opens us to the gifts our lives have to offer and to the grace we are in our lives. Pray, faith. Amen. In that spirit, let us build a house.
Okay. Well, why don't we stand as you are able? Let's sing ourselves out a little bit. Although I think there's a little bit more after this. Don't leave right away. Sorry, Grant. I'm trying to just send people out of here. Get out of here. Okay, this is a fun one, but it's tricky. Okay, I'll admit I'm not perfect. You know, trying to get all the chords in while getting all the words. If I mess up, you just keep going, okay? Just help me, okay? I'm going to do my best. I'm a professional. We can do this.
Let us build a house where love can dwell and all can safely live. A place where saints and children tell how hearts learn to forgive. Built of hope and dreams and visions, rock of faith and vault of grace. Here the love of Christ shall end divisions. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place. Let us build a house where prophets speak and words are strong and true. Where all God's children dare to see, to dream God's reign anew. Here the cross shall stand as a witness and a symbol of God's grace. Here as one we claim the faith of Jesus. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place. Let us build a house where love is found in water, wine, and weeds. A banquet hall
all on holy ground where peace and justice meet. Hear the outcast and the stranger.
See, I told you.
Held in time and space as we share in Christ the feast. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place.
Okay, I'm getting it back.
Let us build a house where hands will reach beyond the wood and stone to heal and strengthen, serve and teach, and live the word they've known. Hear the outcast and the stranger, bear the image of God's face. Let us bring an end to fear and danger. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place. Let us build a house where all are named, their songs and visions heard, and loved and treasured, taught and claimed as words within the word. Built of tears and cries and laughter, prayers of faith and songs of grace. Let this house proclaim from floor to rafter, all are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place.
Thank you, Andrew. Wonderful. Good.
Only a couple mistakes. It was all right.
Before you go, Faith and Coffee. Gloria, do you want to say a couple of words on that in the books? Well, you can talk about the whole thing, yes. Faith and Coffee, I can talk about Faith and Coffee. This Wednesday, we're exploring the whole passage that you began today, which is Isaiah 40:1-11. And then after that, we have the other outreach section. Oh, no, it's not quite yet. All right, sorry, I called you up too soon. But visit the Wish Tree, and the children will give you a card. Fill out the card, take the card to the hub, and the gift cards will be purchased for you. Last day to support the community fundraising, Country Handcraft Market, open till 3, quilt raffle, drawn at 1.
There we go.
Here we go, yeah. Actually, why don't you, oh, you're taking it out, all right. Give it a try.
Is it on? Yeah, yes, okay. So, for those of you who know me from past endeavors with a firm that I've been around, kicking around here for a while, and you may not see me that often, except maybe running out the back quick to get home to turn on a Zoom. So we have two things that go on behind after church, and one is Faith Rumblings, which started back during the pandemic, and Red Deer Lake Reads. And so these two things help us to connect in ways when we can't be here. So we have people who join in from all over the world. We have Carola, who is a member of our congregation, who comes in and sits with us from South Africa weekly, except she's busy this week. And a lady in Niagara Falls, and people from Saskatchewan and Mexico, and you name it, we've had all kinds of people join us. So it's a place where people can join when they can't be here, and it gives us that extra little outreach. Well, right now, for the next 3 weeks, we're doing this book, and it's called The Book of Joy. And there are three people who were involved in this book. The Dalai Lama, who is a Tibetan monk who still is alive. Archbishop Desmond Tutu, who was from South Africa. He actually died on Boxing Day a couple of years ago. and Abrams, I think is, I can't remember his first name, Douglas, thank you. But anyways, and so he does a little joke about this. Abrams does a joke. He says, there are three people who go into a bar, and he says, it's a Tibetan monk, an Anglican archbishop, and a Jew, and what transpires. Well, a couple of years ago was the Dalai Lama's 80th birthday, and so Desmond Tutu was very sick, battling prostate cancer. But Desmond Tutu Archbishop Tutu and the Dalai Lama were very close friends, and they had been for a long time. And people didn't really know this, but Abrams knew this. And so he got Archbishop on a plane and took him to India, where the Dalai Lama is, because the Tibetans have been ousted from their native area, and they live in a part of India. And so they got together and they wrote this book of joy. And so about 2 months ago, the friend who's in Niagara Falls, who's also a church secretary, suggested this book because she thought this would be an excellent book for Advent. And so it's divided into sections, and so today we're going to be looking at up to page 78. Now, do you have to have read the book? It would be advisable, but if you don't, you're welcome to come and sit and listen. We will meet at 12:30. It's up to you. We have people who do come and just listen and don't talk, and that's fine. We welcome everybody, and it's always a good time. It's a time of community. And so we welcome you to come and be with us this Sunday, next Sunday, the Sunday after, as we divide up this book and talk about it and think about how joy can be within our lives too. Who are these people who are talking? Well, both Tutu and the Dalai Lama have gone through a lot in their lives, and so they welcome us to look at how we can survive even when there's all kinds of crap that goes on. So we welcome you to be there. Thank you.
Thank you. Just give me the mic again. There we go. Fran, do you want to say something about the concert quickly? You don't even need to come up. I'll give you the mic over there.
This afternoon from 2:30 till 4:30 in this sanctuary, there will be a performance by the High Country Chorale. It's a concert of your favorite songs, secular and sacred, intermingled. And we are stressing more this year audience participation. So you're going to get to sing along to many of your favorite carols, which a lot of people miss because they just don't do as much of that anymore. So if you're longing for that and wanting to start your celebrations for the Christmas season, please come this afternoon, 2:30 to 4:30. Thank you. It's free. It's admission by donation. So there is a basket. You can put in whatever you want. If you can't, that's fine too. And there are lovely goodies at the end as well. So, and door prizes. So hope to see you there. Thank you.
Next Sunday night will be our Blue Christmas service. For those of you who have seen the past year is not one of the best and who will maybe have trouble singing Joy to the World and some of the other things, but have that need to celebrate Christmas in a different way, and this service will be for you. So that's next Sunday night. And now, the benediction. Go out into the world. Find your place of comfort. Reflect. Sense God's presence with you right there. And then God's presence with you as you go out there. And I'd like you to start that process now. We usually go out, begin talking the second we've become standing. Today I'd like you just to sit in your chair until you feel some comfort, and then go out quietly, and when you get through that door, burst forward into the joyous action of the Christmas season. Peace be with you. Amen.